We're happy to have Brother Aaron Haggard with us today to speak at this hour. Aaron and his wife, Alyssa, have two children, Jack and Carson. And Aaron is a graduate of the Brown Trail School of Preaching and is now in his eighth year of ministry at the Birdville congregation over in Haltom City. And Aaron is a careful student of the Word of God and presents it so very well. We were pleased to have him in our summer series here on Wednesday nights this past summer and did a fine job there. And we've been looking forward to having him on this program, and we're glad that he is here today. His topic from the book of Ephesians, unity based on the seven ones. And so let's get our Bibles out and let's study together.
I want you to imagine to your left here a cot. And on that cot is a little girl, 12 years old, and she's very sick. So sick, she's almost dead. The family has all but given up hope. Preparations are likely being made for her death. That is, until her father, Jairus, hears that Jesus is in town. Can you imagine Jairus running to meet Jesus, doing all that he could to break through the crowd that was most certainly around him? We know the Bible says at this point in Jesus' ministry, the crowds would throng around him. So many people would be around Jesus that you couldn't even tell who touched you. He makes his way to Jesus. The Bible says he falls at his feet. He begs him. He pleads with him. He beseeches him that if you would only come and lay your hands on my daughter, she would be made well and she would live. The Apostle Paul in Ephesians chapter 4 in verse 1, when he says, I beseech you that you walk worthy of the calling with which you were called. He uses exactly the same word that is used in Mark chapter 5 to describe that father Jairus begging Jesus to come and to heal his daughter. Now, I know that context most certainly determines the intensity of a word like parakaleo. But if you know Paul, you know that he wanted the church to be one just as much as Jairus wanted his daughter to live. But why? Why would the Apostle Paul care so much about the unity and oneness of the body of Christ? Well, he's just spent the last three chapters in Ephesians 1, 2, and 3 telling us exactly the cost of us being one in the body of Christ. For us to be a family, for Jews and Gentiles to come together in one place, in one body, the cost was severe. The cost was great. Jesus asked, if there's any other way, I'm all for it. But there was no other way for us to be one in the body of Christ other than the blood of Jesus Christ himself. You see, the cost of our oneness is great. I want you to think for a moment all that Jesus Christ had to experience while he was on this earth so that you and I can be one in the body of Christ, so that you and I can be the family of God. Think about the rejection that he faced from his own family. They didn't understand him. They didn't get him. They didn't believe him. They didn't follow him. They thought he was crazy. Rejection from his own countrymen, his own Jewish brethren, who would hand him over to the Romans for him to be killed. He was insulted time and time again. One of the greatest insults ever spoken to Jesus or ever thought about Jesus was that he did his miracles by the power of Beelzebul. That is, by the power of the God of the dunghill. That's what they said about Jesus. He was betrayed by one of his own, by one of his close companions, by Judas Iscariot, who sold him out for 30 pieces of silver. For nothing. For the value of a slave under the Old Testament. That's what Jesus was sold for. They wanted to kill him. Could you imagine walking around amongst your own people, knowing that they wanted you dead? Don't think for a moment that the cross was the first time they tried to kill Jesus. It was almost as though from the beginning of his ministry, they were looking for an opportunity to take him out. Finally, they got their hands on our Lord and on our Savior. What did they do to him? They slapped him. They mocked him. They beat him until he was almost dead. They put a crown of thorns on his head, a cross on his back that they would nail him to, pierce his hands and his feet. He would bleed. He would die for our oneness. The cost of our oneness is great. Do you understand why Paul is begging and pleading for us to be one? Because he just finished three chapters telling us what God had went through, what Jesus had gone through, so that we could be called God's family, so that we could be the body, the church of Christ. Isn't it amazing that we're even here? You ever thought about that? That all these people are together in one place, in one body? What an amazing testimony our oneness is. In John chapter 17, Jesus is praying. He prays for himself. He prays for his disciples. And he prays for us. He prays for those that would believe after them. One of the things he prays for is for our unity, for our oneness. Why was Jesus so concerned about our oneness? Because he declares that when we are one, we are a testimony of him. That we declare his reality to the world, as well as the love of God. When we come together and live as the body of Christ, when we act and work and function as one people, united together by Christ and by his blood, it's a fantastic testimony to the world of Christ and our loving Heavenly Father. I want you to think about your home congregation for a minute and just how different you all are. Different races, different ages. Some are wealthy, some are not. Some have a lot of letters after their name and some don't. Some are employed and some are unemployed. Some are retired and some are stay-at-home moms. Some are Aggie fans and some are Longhorn fans. All in the same place. What fantastic thing possibly could have happened to these people? I want you to think about the personalities of the people in your home congregation. I bet there are a few people, a few special people just like you, that you get along with. Did you have a kind of a kindred spirit with? Did you kind of think the same, act the same, talk the same? You're pretty much on the same page with a handful of just a few special people. But I'd be willing to reckon that most people aren't like you. And yet here we are. We're all in one body of Christ, coming together, loving God and worshiping him. loving each other, calling each other family. We use words like brother and sister. That's very special. How did that happen? How did it happen that we've all come together as one people? You see, when we come together and act like the family of God, we are a testimony to the world of the change that has happened within us. That Christ and His cross have affected us. That we've been changed by the gospel of Jesus Christ. That we've all recognized that we're all sinners in need of a Savior. That we've all been baptized into Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of our sins, that we might become one as the body of Christ. When we come together and act and live and function and desire to be as one, we are a testimony to the world of the cross of Jesus Christ, of His salvation, and the love of our heavenly Father. What a great testimony it is as we live as one in the body. If you don't already have your Bibles open to Ephesians chapter 4, I want to read verses 11 through 16 with you. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 through 16. And He Himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists and some pastors and teachers for the equipping of the saints for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we should no longer be children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the trickery of men and the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up in all things into Him who is the head, Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by what every joint supplies, according to the effective working by which every part does its share, causes the growth of the body for the edifying of itself in love. Now, we all know that Paul is kind of the king of the run-on sentence, so he says a lot here in just a few verses. I want us to understand exactly what's going on here. So he introduces this section by saying that there's a lot of church offices that God gave us: apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. What was the purpose of these? Till we come to what? Unity of the faith. I want you to realize that this word unity is the same word unity used in Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 3. Henotes, which means oneness, till we come to oneness of the body, till we come to oneness of the faith. Why was the Apostle Paul, why was God so concerned that His church be unified when it comes to our faith, the things we believe, the things we live, the things we teach? Well, notice what he says in verse 14. That we should no longer be children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the trickery of men and the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting. When we are the body of Christ and we act and live and function as one, and we are unified in our faith, it doesn't matter what wind of false doctrine is blowing around out there in the world, it's not going to affect us. Doesn't matter what teacher or theologian or professor or preacher or elder or deacon or whoever comes up with whatever new idea is out there right now. When we have decided and determined that our faith comes from the Word of God, that it tells us what to believe, it tells us how to live, it tells us how the church should function, nothing is going to take us down. Because we are committed to God and to His Word and to that faith that was once and for all delivered to the saints. So instead of being tossed about by every wind of doctrine, what then happens to the body of Christ? Notice what he says in verses 15 and 16. But speaking the truth in love, may grow up in all things unto Him who is the head, Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by what every joint supplies, according to the effective working by which every part does its share, causes growth of the body for the edifying of itself in love. When we commit ourselves to be one together and one in faith, we're not tossed about by every wind of doctrine. No, instead, we grow up as the body of Christ to be all that Christ ever imagined us to be. Are you beginning to understand why the Apostle Paul is begging and pleading with us to be one? But how are we going to do it? How is it that all these people from all their backgrounds with all their personalities can come together in the body of Christ and be one? Well, notice Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 through 3. I believe the Apostle Paul gives us at least five solid ways we can be one in the body of Christ. I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling with which you were called, with all lowliness and gentleness, with long-suffering, bearing with one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. How can we be one in the body of Christ like God wants us to be? Well, it takes lowliness. Lowliness means having a humble opinion about yourself. I think we all need that. I'm not that great. I'm not that smart. I haven't arrived. I'm not that righteous. I'm not that perfect. There's more I can learn. There's more ways I can grow. There's more about God I need to figure out, more about the Word of God I need to know. What if we all carried around that attitude? Think about that. What if preachers brought that in the pulpit every time they spoke and talked? That's sobering for me. What if we brought that same attitude to every elders' meeting when we met with our shepherds? If the body of Christ can maintain this attitude, all of us that we're not nearly as great as sometimes we think we are, the church can truly be one. Gentleness. Gentleness. How do you interact with each other? Are you gentle? Are you loving? Are you kind? Or are you harsh? Are you critical? Are you loving one another? Or are you tearing one another down? Are you devouring one another? We've been called to be gentle to each other, loving and kind and patient and long-suffering. How do you speak to one another? Are you careful with the words that you choose? Are you edifying one another? Or are you shoving one another down? If the body of Christ wants to truly be one, we've got to be gentle. We've got to be long-suffering. The Apostle Paul told Timothy that his preaching would take long-suffering. Why is that? Because I figured out people are slow to change. Think about anything you've ever changed in your life. How quickly did you do it? Or did it take a long time? So why is it then that many times we preachers get in the pulpit with expectations of preaching something one time and everybody just going out and doing it? Not understanding that preaching is foolishness because we have to get up and say it over and over and over and over and over again. Why? Because people are slow to change. And people are imperfect. We're all imperfect. If the body of Christ is going to be one, it's going to happen because we are long-suffering people. Because when that one brother or that one sister steps out of line, we learn to surround them with patience and endurance and long-suffering for the sake of our relationships, for the sake of our family, for the sake of the body of Christ, bearing with one another in love. I like to see this as sometimes you just have to put up with each other. Sometimes we are going to do things and say things that are ridiculous towards one another. Things are going to come out of our mouths that are stupid, that we never should say, things we never should do. So what do we do in those cases? Leave the body? I'm done with this. I'm done with organized religion. I'm done with the body of Christ. I'm done with the church of Christ. I'm done with that congregation. That's not what God called us to. That's not what Jesus died for. That's not testifying to the world of the greatness of Christ and His sacrifice and the love of God. Sometimes we just have to put up with one another, bear with one another. He goes on to say, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. I want to zero in on that word, endeavoring. Endeavoring means to work hard, to be diligent. Think about this. What would the body of Christ look like if every single member of the body were working so hard to be lowly and gentle and long-suffering, bearing with one another in love? If we want to be one, this would be a great start in doing so. The last three verses of our section today, Ephesians chapter 4, verses 4, 5, and 6, the Apostle Paul gives us those classic seven ones. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you're called, and one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father who is above all and through all and in you all. This is a great text. Everybody uses it. You can use it to talk about baptism. You can use it to talk about the church as opposed to denominations. You can use it to talk about the one faith versus a multiplicity of faiths. This is a great launch pad for those kind of discussions. But I want to keep these three verses in context. Why did the Apostle Paul follow the first three verses of Ephesians chapter 4 with these seven ones? I believe it's because these seven ones all point back to the oneness that we are supposed to have as the body of Christ. All seven of these things relate to our oneness. I also believe they might even qualify our oneness. That is to say, how one should we be as the body of Christ? Well, how many gods are there? Just one? Well, that kind of one. How close should we be? How one should we be as the body of Christ? Well, how many lords are there? Just one Lord. Well, that kind of one. We are to be one as the body of Christ, and our oneness flows out of these seven ones here in Ephesians 4, verses 4, 5, and 6. There is only one body. There is only one body. There is only one group of saved people. There is only one church. Ephesians chapter 5 verse 23 tells us that the body is the church. What happens then if we decide to grow complacent and lazy when it comes to the body of Christ? What if we are okay with division in the one body? How do you think God feels about that? You know, the Corinthian church was okay with division. As was mentioned in the lesson previous to this one, some said, I'm Apollos, I'm of Paul, I'm of Cephas, I am of Christ. They were okay with their division. God wasn't. Paul wasn't. He goes on to say in 1 Corinthians 1:17 that if you maintain this kind of division amongst the body of Christ, you have made the cross of Christ of no effect. What he's saying here is, it's as though the cross of Christ never happened in your life. That it never changed anything about you. The cross of Christ is not merely about your personal salvation. It's about bringing all of us together as one in the body of Christ. So to be okay and complacent about division in the body, Paul says, is to make the cross of Christ of no effect. We have to be one as the body of Christ. One body, one Spirit, one Holy Spirit who is working in every aspect of the body of Christ. One Holy Spirit who has revealed the mystery of the gospel to us. The mystery of salvation through Christ. The mystery of the redemption of Jews and Gentiles and all of us coming together in one body. The Holy Spirit is there when we're baptized into Christ for the remission of our sins. The Holy Spirit, according to Ephesians chapter 6, is there when we pray. According to 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 13, it is the work of the Holy Spirit that brings us together in the body of Christ and keeps us together in the body of Christ. It's no wonder why when we fail to endeavor to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace, according to Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 3, that according to Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 30, we grieve the Holy Spirit. When we decide, I don't care about the oneness of the body, I'm going to talk to you however I want to, I'm going to do however I want to, I don't care about division in the body of Christ, Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 30 teaches us plainly that we grieve the Holy Spirit. One Spirit, one hope. You know, we need to remember that. Why are you all here? Really? Why are you all here? Why have you all become a part of the body of Christ? Why have you left the world of sin and been baptized into Jesus Christ? Because of the one hope that we have. Titus chapter 3 and verse 7 teaches us that the one hope we have as the body of Christ is resurrection to life. That's why you're here, because you want to go to heaven. That's why you're here, because you want to be saved from your sins and one day spend forever with God in heaven. One hope. We are all here for exactly the same reasons. You know, I think about oneness. I do think about God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit all one together. I think about the body of Christ and how one we should be with each other. But I also think about a husband and a wife. The Bible says that the two flesh shall become what?
One.
The Bible also said that those two people should be heirs together of the grace of life. What if we saw each other that way as Christians? We're all heirs together of the grace of life. How close would we be? How inclined would we be to bicker and argue? How inclined would we be to help each other get to heaven instead of hinder? How concerned would we be about the oneness of the body of Christ if we saw each other as heirs together of the grace of life? There's one hope for the body and one Lord. One Lord, one Master, one Jesus Christ who has authority in heaven and on earth. One Jesus Christ who commands us to be one. It's not an option. It's not a choice. We're commanded to be one. So when you grow complacent, when you're okay with division amongst brothers and sisters in Christ, I want you to remember two things. One, the cost of your oneness that we talked about earlier. The great cost, the blood of Jesus Christ. But also that it is Jesus Christ who commands us to be one. So when you are rejecting your brother or sister in Christ, you're not just rejecting them. You're rejecting Christ. Your Lord, your Master, your Savior. It is He who commands us to be one. It is He who wants us to be one as a testimony to the world of His death, burial, and resurrection, and as a testimony of the love of our Heavenly Father. There is but one Lord. And one faith. One faith. One way of living. One system of belief. One theology. One guidebook for our life. The Word of God. There is but one faith. Once and for all delivered to the saints according to Jude 3. That's it. One faith that is pleasing to God. Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 6. We as the body of Christ, according to Philippians chapter 1 and verse 27, should be striving together for the faith of the gospel. Working with each other, doing everything we can to help one another stay faithful. 1 John chapter 1 and verse 7 tells us some interesting things about this. It says, if we walk in the light as He is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and His blood will forgive us and cleanse us of our sins. So think about it this way. When we are faithful, we are unified and one with each other. But also when we are one with each other, we are faithful. And so faithfulness and oneness go hand in hand in the body of Christ. There is but one faith, once and for all delivered to the saints. And we are called by, as the body of Christ, to help each other live out and strive for that one faith. One baptism. one baptism. Every Christian can trace their beginning in Christ back to the very same event. We all had our new birth in Christ in baptism. We were all baptized into Jesus Christ, born again, begotten of the Holy Spirit, all the way back at our baptism. We're all baptized into the same death of Christ, all made to drink into the one Holy Spirit of God, all raised to walk in newness of life as a brand new creation. There is but one baptism and one God. One God. We don't serve a multiplicity of gods with their numerous rules. We serve one God with one plan of salvation that involves all the seven ones that we talked about today. One body, one spirit, one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father who is above all and through all and in you all. And our God wants us desperately to be one. Now we still have our little 12-year-old girl over here who's sick and she's almost dead. And Jairus comes in with Jesus and Jesus clears the room of all the unfaithful. He says to that little girl, arise. He takes her by the hand and she walks and everybody's amazed. I truly and honestly believe today that God is reaching out to His people through the Word. He's calling us to endeavor to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. He says, if you can, my people can truly be one, you can amaze the world with the cross of Christ and the love of your Heavenly Father.